Thank you. Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. It's wonderful to see all of you. Welcome to church this morning. For those of you watching at home on TV or on your computer, welcome to the church this morning. Welcome to our service. This morning, you'll notice that I'm not wearing my shirt and tie today. And for those of you that are attending the potluck after church, which is the 55 and older potluck for our church members and friends and family, we're going to be down there today. The Health Ministries Department will be doing health screenings today. We're not going to do the entire health fair that we do, but we are going to do cholesterol, blood pressure, glucose, and other screenings. So if you'd like to come down and have that done while you're before potluck today, we'll be there, and you're more than welcome to come down, and we'll be happy to do those screenings for you. Someone pointed out this week, we spend so much time ministering to the community with health ministries services. We don't do as much for our own church family, so this is a chance for us this week to minister to our own here at the church. So please come down. If you're a member of the Golden Buckeye Club, come on down, and we will be happy to do some health screenings for you before potluck today. To start the announcements today, I'm going to invite Debbie Adeniran to come up. She is our home and school director at the Academy and has a special announcement, I believe, about Valentine's Day.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. I know you've seen me before. I'm back just to remind you about the Valentine event that's coming up on February 13th. While home and school, we've had one last year, and this is going to be the second annual Valentine event. We're looking forward to seeing you all there. For those of you that weren't here the first time that I made the announcement, I just want to repeat a little bit of the information for it. So it's on February 13th, it starts at 7 p.m., and it's going to be right here in the Fellowship Hall. The price per person is $10, and that's half slashed from what we asked for last year. Now, the one other thing is we are looking for table sponsors. I know that some of you, God has blessed you so much that you cannot contain it. So then you want to give some of that to a good cause. And what more than students' education, Adventist education? It's a fundraiser for the school, and we look forward to you approaching us and letting us know that, well, God has blessed me. I want to bless you with one table. Price per table is $100. If you want to do half a table, that's welcome. And also, even if you don't want to do a table sponsor, you can actually sponsor other people to come. Because the deal is, we do not want to leave anyone behind who wants to be part of this program. So we may have members who do not have the $10 to pay, but that should not be a reason for them not to come. So if they would let us know that they want to be part of it, because it's usually fun, let me tell you that. We have a lot of fun. It's there's dinner, there's going to be music. We're featuring a musician on that night. And then we're going to have a session during the program that's going to be that's titled Love and Laughter. For that piece, I would like you to approach me, couples or individuals who have a short story to share about your life, maybe when your children are growing, when you were dating your husband or your wife, and something that you just want to share with us that's going to make us laugh and praise the Lord. That's the goal. And it's going to be for just about 2 or 3 minutes. Bear that in mind. Let me know if you have one story that you want to share like that. And program starts. Well, we usually ask for dress to be formal, because the reason for that is because we take pictures and we want you to be proud of your picture, and we want you to be able to display it in your home or in your album and be happy to look at it in the future, just to say, well, this was when I went to the Valentine event at WAC and WAA. Thank you and have a happy Sabbath. We would have this. Last Sabbath, we distributed the invitations in the bulletins. Next Sabbath, we're going to have them in the bulletins again. I was a little late to put them in the bulletins this morning. But I will have a few of them laying on the table out there in the foyer. When you come out, if you need one, please grab one. Happy Sabbath.
Thank you very much. It's so been exciting to see these events grow. I don't know how many of you came to our Fall Fest this year, but the Fall Festival was quite a bit of fun. I, for one, saw the pastor ride the mechanical bull at Fall Fest, and had a great time with that. And then the Valentine's Banquet, these are all events that help support the school and our community, and it's neat to see these events growing year after year, so thank you very much for your leadership on that, Deb. So a couple quick things I just want to mention. Please take a quick chance to look at your bulletin. There's lots and lots of things going on at the church. Too many to go into right now. But if you take a look, you can see some of the things that are coming up. You know about our new children's choir that is beginning. Please, if you have interest or would like to help with that, let the church office know. We have lots of needs and ministries around. We're highlighting again the Bible studies that are going on for the ladies, also for the men. So please take a look at that. There's many, many opportunities to get involved at our church. So please take it, feel the Spirit's call. And if you see things going on around you and you think to yourself, boy, I would love to be involved in that, let us know. We would love to invite you in and have you help. As our church is growing, there are more and more opportunities for us to help each other and help the community. At this time, we're going to start our service by welcoming those among us who might be new. If you have a chance right now, we're going to sing Family of God together. Meet someone you don't already know, shake someone's hand, and then we'll begin with our opening song. Thank you all.
Standing for opening hymn 326. It's such a beautiful day, and be thankful that the Lord can open your eyes to see this beautiful sunshine. Hymn 326. Let's sing together. Everyone together.
Open mine eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open thine eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Second stanza. Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything fake will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open mine ears, illumine me, Spirit divine.
Last stanza without the instruments. Everyone with me.
Open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share.
Chorus now.
Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my heart, illumine me. Spirit divine.
It's time for our morning prayer, and those of you who would rather stand, you may stand. Those who would like to kneel, if you would do so at this time, please. Before I pray, I'd like for everyone to take a minute or so and just say a silent prayer, and then I will finish the opening prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this beautiful morning. Lord, you've been so gracious to us this winter. And the sunshine reminds me of spring. And when we think of February, we can always say, spring is coming next month. Praise the Lord. We thank you for the seasons, Lord. And we thank you for the blessings that you give us, because they come every day. Lord, we have so many people in our congregation that are having problems, illnesses. Linda Heisel, Deborah Crum, Tom Esman, Eva Gates. And Lord, we think of Charles Williams. His wife is back in the hospital, supposedly on a ventilator. And it goes on and on and on and on. But Lord, we know that when we go through the fire, it makes us better people. We thank you for the trials and tribulations. We thank you more, Lord, that someday there will be no more trials, no more tribulation. We long for that day that we can be with you. Give us a blessed Sabbath. Bless the soloist, the music, the minister, and the offering. We ask all these things in your Son's name we pray. Amen. At this time, the deacons can come forward. They're working me to death this morning, but it's okay. It's been kind of a tough week out there traveling, and seems like all the patients I see are very, very ill. But even so, God is blessing. We have some really young deacons here in the center, and some moderately old deacons on it. Well, I didn't look over there, but anyway. I tell you, we had a finance committee meeting and we've had a board meeting. The Lord is awesome and you guys are awesome. Our Christmas club, believe it or not, we raised around $30,000. Say amen. Give the Lord a hand. Now understand this, you didn't do it, he did it. And I think we're thinking about using the Christmas club again. And over and above that, you gave more money. We are truly in the black. And you know what next month is, don't you? What is it? Amen. So we want to stay in the black, because as I say, black don't crack. Okay. But you guys are awesome. I'm telling you, we were elated in the meetings, and it just goes to show on our roll, I think we have, 803 people? Is that it? And these are people, now I don't know how active they all are, but you guys are doing it. And we're thinking about, we're going to start earlier this year, so I'm going to be on you again. You know, they made me the stewardship chairman. It's the office in the church that nobody wants to have. So that's the reason why they gave it to me, but you guys are wonderful.
Because you know the song about the pockets.
I'm sorry?
Because you know the song about the pockets.
Oh, that's right, the song. You know what the guy said? He said, I don't want that green salad of lettuce. I want that green salad of money. He said, don't you holler. Don't you shout. Turn those pockets. I'm teaching you guys well. And you got to dig a little deeper in the storehouse of the Lord. Okay? And don't give. You give until it hurts. You give until it quits hurting. Okay? Let's bow our heads. Don't forget to give. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the way that you do things for us, Lord. We see Clarence back after surgery. Muncie's back after surgery. And there's other people that have had surgery or are doing well. Lord, you're blessing all the time. We ask, Lord, that you would bless this offering this morning because it's for the furtherance of your kingdom. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Trina. That was beautiful. Thank you. Good morning, church family, and what a beautiful day the Lord has given us. Can you believe this weather? Whoa. Well, we've resurrected an old, old tune, song, hymn. The song Beulah Land. Now, you seniors may remember this, but I'm sure the young folks probably have never heard it before. Beulah Land was originally written in 1896 by Edgar Stites, and was based on Isaiah 62:4, which is about the Israelites returning to the land God promised them. In 1976, Squire Parsons wrote another version entitled it Sweet Beulah Land, good old Southern gospel. And this was based on John Bunyan's book, Pilgrim's Progress. The term Beulah Land was defined as the land in which the pilgrim awaits the call of the celestial city. looking now across the river, where my faith will end in sight. There's just a few more days to labor, then I will
and thank you so much for giving a little bit of the background of the song. For those of you who still are wondering what this Beulah land means, the book of Isaiah, starting from chapter 55 and on, 56 and on, talks about the dream of God, that one day the land is not going to be desolate. And 62, the chapter 62, talks about the land being desolate without the Gentiles among the Hebrew people. And God says, and your land is not going to be called anymore desolate and forsaken, but it is going to be called my delight is in her. And it will be Beulah land, which means a land that has, it's a marital kind of figure, a land that is not a widow anymore. You'll have your husband. And I'm your husband, God says, and I'm going to take good care of you. And he says this is going to happen when my people, the Gentiles, are going to fill Jerusalem. So it's a beautiful song. Thank you so much, Mansi. Thank you. Appreciate it. Now, as our team puts my presentation on the screen, I would like to remind those of you who have not been with us, or maybe you are for the first time here, we're still in the book of Acts, and we're in chapter 21 of the book of Acts. I told you already twice that this is a chapter that I have anticipated for a long time. First, because in a sense it's like the heart of the book of Acts. It reveals something about God that the church has needed for so long and we have completely forgotten. Last time we studied the end of Apostle Paul's journey. He entered Jerusalem, and the Council of Jerusalem, this is so to say the general conference of the Seventh-day Israelites, accepted him and listened to his report. And then they tried to force Apostle Paul to twist his arms into doing something that he was not very comfortable doing, namely to go in the temple of Jerusalem to pay for the sacrifices animal sacrifices for man, and first to cleanse himself ritually through another set of rituals and sacrifices. So Apostle Paul agreed to do it because he loved his brethren. And his brethren were hoping that when Apostle Paul does that, finally he's going to prove to all Jewish people that Christianity is a Jewish religion, that Paul is in compliance with the ceremonial law, and it's a business as usual. The good old religion stands and it's good enough. And yet, it looked that for a time being, this plan is going to work. Only 7 days later, the temple actually erupted. Tempest broke out in the temple. And this is the title of my message today. God interrupted this process through which Paul was willing to go to show them that he does not need animal sacrifices anymore. And today we're going to conclude this study and study a little bit about the after effect, what happened when Paul went to the temple. And I would like to tackle one question in particular. Here's the question. What makes some Bible reading, Bible believing, Sabbath keeping, kosher eating people religious terrorists? What makes, I'm not going to talk today about ISIS and Al-Qaeda. This is a different topic and it requires a little bit more study than that. But today the passage that we are going to study, the passage is going to answer for us this question. What makes some religious people, Bible believing, Bible reading people, what turns us sometimes into religious fanatics, into suicide bombers? We are smarter than these guys from Al-Qaeda and ISIS. We do not detonate physical bombs. We detonate some spiritual bombs. But they have as deadly effect as the physical ones, I can tell you. And we're going to see in a bit. So let's discover what causes some religious, good religious people to become pretty fanatical. And the passage we're going to study today will give us three reasons for biblical fanaticism. Are you ready? Oh boy, you look like you're asleep on me. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, grab your Bibles. Let's open them to the book of Acts, chapter 21. And please, someone lift up her or his hand and read for us in chapter 21, verses 26 through 30. Mary Friend is willing to read, David. So let's hear the word of God. It's the red one.
The next day, Paul took the men and purified himself along with them. Then he went to the temple to give notice of the date when the days of purification would end and the offering would be made for each of them. When the 7 days were nearly over, some Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul at the temple. They stirred up the whole crowd and seized him, shouting, "Men of Israel, help us! This is the man who teaches all men everywhere against our people and our law and this place. And besides, he has brought Greeks into the temple area and defiled this holy place." They had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with Paul and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple area.
Okay. Well, one more, yes.
The whole city was aroused, and the people came running from all directions. Seizing Paul, they dragged him from the temple, and immediately the gates were shut.
Thank you, Mary Friend. Do you notice who were the people who spotted Paul and accuse him that he is destroying the values of Judaism. Do you know from where? Do you notice from where they were? They're from Asia. This is Asia Minor. This is not the continent of Asia. I've noticed over the years something, because I've traveled all over the world. Americans who live outside of America are more Americans than the ones who live inside it. The same is true about the Germans, the same is true about the Africans and all these things. We become more cautious of who we are, and we become more eager to defend our nationalism when we are minority. And this is exactly what's happening here. These people from Asia Minor, the place where Apostle Paul has spent 3 years preaching the gospel and had enormous success, these are the people who point the finger to him and say, this is the guy who is destroying Judaism. Now, I would like you to pay attention to verse 28. You can either look up in your Bibles or look here on the screen. They say, this is the man who teaches against, and three things are mentioned. Do you notice? The people, in Greek, the word is very specific. It refers to the people of God, to Israel. The second thing is what? The law, and from the context we know this is the law of Moses, the law of sacrifices. And finally, he teaches against what? This place, and the place they refer to is the temple. If you were to ask a Jewish person in the first century, what are the pillars of Judaism? What is the foundation? What are the fundamental beliefs? The fundamental beliefs of the fundamental beliefs of Judaism. They'll point to three pillars of Judaism. The first one is the law of Moses. The second is the uniqueness of Israel as people of God, as the remnant of God, as people who are above anyone else in the world. And finally, they'll point to the temple as a symbol of their nation, as a symbol of their unique status before God. Now, allow me to explain a little bit why they were so upset with Apostle Paul. From their perspective, the theology of Apostle Paul was destroying the good old religion. First, if you read the context, this incident happens during the Pentecost, during the Feast of Pentecost. Every Jewish person, even today, if you ask him, what is the Feast of the Pentecost all about? They'll tell you, according to Jewish tradition, God gave the law of Moses on Pentecost. Every single Jew believes that. You can ask them even today, even more so back then. So Apostle Paul is in Jerusalem, in the temple, on the day and time when all the Jewish people celebrate the essence of Judaism, the law of Moses. And here is the guy who in Asia Minor has preached that the law of Moses with the sacrifices are not necessary. Sacrifices are not necessary for our salvation, that Jesus is enough. The second thing that ticked off the Jewish people of the first century, Jews saw in Paul a traitor, because his mission was destroying the second pillar of Judaism. He was destroying their uniqueness. Up to this point, in order for you to become part of the people of God, you have to become Jewish. You have to become circumcised. You have to go through a ritual cleansing from your Gentileness. And you have to make a sacrifice of an animal. Apostle Paul teaches, not necessary. You can become a child, a son, a daughter of God, only by accepting Jesus. You don't need to be circumcised. You don't have to become a Jewish person. And yet, the Jewish people were upset with that, even though what Paul was doing was absolutely biblical. I've put here Isaiah 49, verse 6. In Isaiah 49, 6, there is a very interesting statement, a prophecy that God gave to his people. He said, I will make Israel light to the Gentiles. And they read, I will make Israel lighthouse, shining from the distance, showing the people where is the direction they have to come and become Jewish like us. When you read though the text in Hebrew, it implies that the Jewish people are going to become light that lives among the Gentiles, disperses the light, and they become part of all the people. The Jewish people become part of all the nations. They didn't like this idea because they didn't feel any more special. They didn't feel like the special remnant of God. They'll have to blend among the other nations. They didn't like it. And finally, they wanted to kill Paul because what Paul was preaching actually nullified the necessity of a temple. What do you do in the temple? You do animal sacrifices. Paul says, not needed anymore, you have Jesus. So basically, the last pillar was taken because Paul was preaching that Jesus is enough. And yet, they have made the temple a very unique structure. The Jerusalem temple in the time of Jesus was divided by two different walls of separation, so that it created three separate areas in the temple. First was the area of the Gentiles, and there was approximately 4 feet tall wall surrounding the whole temple complex. And there were signs, they were actually excavated. It's true. Not just what we read through Josephus, but these signs were excavated, and they say, you trespass over this point, and then you're going to be put to death, and you're going to be responsible for your own blood. The second area was the area of the women. Women, the court of the women, women were not allowed to come in the presence where the sacrifice was made. They were only able to hear the priest pronouncing the blessing. They were able to hear the trumpet, the shofar blowing. They were able to hear the choir singing. But only men were able to stand right there and see how the sacrifice was happening. And Paul was saying, all these divisions, over. And the guys didn't like the idea. They didn't like the idea, and verse 30 and 31 tell us, they seized Paul, seeking to do what? Seeking to do what? They were eager to murder Apostle Paul. Listen very well, why? Because he touched the core beliefs of their religion. He touched the truth with a lowercase t. And they were willing to do what? They were becoming terrorists to defend the truth with a lowercase t. Here's the first reason why people, why while people who are reading the Bible, worshiping every Sabbath, eating kosher, become religious fanatics. When Bible-believing people reduce their faith to a set of beliefs, they are bound to become religious fanatics. They'll be ready to tear down and to tear apart anyone who challenges the truth with a lowercase t. And I know I'm talking here to Seventh-day Adventists. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. And I believe in every one of our fundamental beliefs, 28, all of them. Yet, I'm telling you that when Bible-believing and Sabbath-keeping and Sabbath and Bible-reading and Bible-whatever-keeping Christians reduce their faith to a set of beliefs, they're ready to become Seventh-day-whatever terrorists, suicide bombers, we're just a little bit smarter. We know that we're going to get in much trouble by blowing ourselves physically. But we, if we reduce our faith to that, to 28 fundamental beliefs, we are bound to become suicide bombers. And I would like to give you an example. As a pastor, I have a front seat view into the lives and the pain of a lot of all of you. And over the years, I've noticed that there are many good Bible reading, praying, Sabbath keeping, kosher eating Adventists whose children are as far away from the church as possible. And they don't want to hear anything about God. And I have asked myself 1,000 times, God, why is this happening? Look at them. They're keeping the Sabbath faithfully. They're eating the proper food. And they're doing this and this. And they're giving tithe. And they're coming to church. And they're doing all the right things. Why are their children running away from you? What's wrong? And then I came to a revelation a few years ago. Many of these Bible reading, Sabbath keeping, kosher eating people have reduced their faith to a set of beliefs. And the only thing that their children have seen is Bible reading, Sabbath church going, and proper eating. Many of us have missed the memo recorded in John chapter 14 verse 6, Jesus speaking. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. There is no way someone can become a Christian and believe and be saved. What Jesus is saying in this verse is that truth is not a set of beliefs. According to the Bible, truth is a person. And you leave the person out of your 27, 28, or how many fundamental beliefs. Or you sprinkle just a little bit of Jesus here and there over your lifestyle. It's not going to cut it, friends. I told you that people who reduce their faith to a set of beliefs are like suicide bombers. Do you know who is the first one who dies when a suicide bomber detonates? Who is the first one who is dying? The suicide bomber. Then who are the second ones who are dying? The people who are closest to them. And the same thing is happening to us, friends, when we reduce our faith to some set of beliefs, even though they may be right. The first one who dies is us. Because set of beliefs cannot neither save you, nor sustain you, nor transform you. The only person that can do that is Jesus. And when we leave him out of that, not only we die from inside out. People who are closest to us also die spiritually. They do not see value in what we are doing. They do not see value in our church going. They do not see value in our practices. Because the only thing that matters in this life is the truth with a capital T. Take the capital T out of truth, and our small truths matter that much. Now let's move on and discover a few more things about the reasons why some good Bible believing and reading Christians become zealots and fanatics. You remember last time we read in verse 20, James, the president of the Jerusalem Council, speaking. He's speaking here to Paul, and he tells him, "You see, brother, the myriads of Jews who have believed, and they're all what? Zealous for what? for Jesus, right? They're all zealous for Jesus. I would like you to pay attention again to this blue highlighted word. You see, brother, how many what?
Myriads.
Myriads is a Greek word, the Greek word for 10,000. But does he say a myriad, or what is this? Plural. That means at least 20,000 Christians were part of the Church of Jerusalem. At least 20,000 Christians. That's a good number, don't you think? And all of them are what? They're zealous for the law. And people who are zealous for the law on Pentecost are to be found where? In the temple. Now, here's the question. Where were the myriads of Jewish Christians? Where were the four people who were right there with Paul when he was in the temple because he was about to sacrifice for them and to pay for 12 animals to be sacrificed on their behalf? Where were the four people, the four Jewish Christians? Where were the tens of thousands of Jewish Christians when Paul was being mistreated, beaten up, and teared to shreds because of Jesus? Where were they? Why were they not there to tell the Jewish people, stop doing that? This is our person. And can you imagine, theoretically, of these 20,000 people, at least 5,000 were present in the precincts of the temple. And there is not one to stand next to Paul and say, if you're going to beat my brother in Christ, you better beat me too. Anyone besides Paul being beaten there? Anyone raising his voice in his defense? Where was the church when the brightest, and I will say probably the most spiritual hero of the early Christian church was being mistreated? Do you know where the Christians were? They were on the side of the bullies. They were on the side of the fanatics. The church was silent. Because the church of Jerusalem was more Jewish than Christian. The church of Jerusalem were first Jews. And second, they were Christian. They sprinkled their nationality with a little bit of Jesus. But their nationality, their national identity came first. Some Bible-believing people are first Americans, they're first Germans, they're first Tutsis and Hutus, and second, or maybe even third, they're Christians. What about you? Some of us are first Democrats, some of us are first Republicans, and then we're Christian. Do you know that this is one of the most dangerous things in the world? This is the recipe for creating suicide bombers. You put anything or anyone else before Jesus. And before some of you get outraged and say, oh, you accent speaking person out there, you're not American, this is why I am American. I swore to this flag. I am American, but I am first Christian. And I have to tell you that, because if we do not figure it out, we are going to repeat the same mistake that has been repeated thousands of times throughout history. And I would like to give you just one example, even though I can give you many more. How many have heard of this guy, Adolf Hitler? My wife and I lived for 5 years in the very place where Adolf Hitler was born. I've heard many stories, I've read many stories. I've seen people who have been through these stories. They've told me firsthand the stories. When Adolf Hitler came in power, He required every single Christian to support his regime. If you were somehow miraculously to get into a time machine and be transported back in time 70 years or so back, and we end up in Germany, Nazi Germany, and you go to church, you enter any church, Adventist, Lutheran, Catholic, you enter any church, on the two sides of the balcony there will be two swastikas. You'll see on this side the swastika hanging, on this side the church banner. Every single church, without exception. Both Catholics and Protestants swore complete allegiance to the regime of Hitler, because they were first Germans and second Christians. Yes, there were few pastors and priests who knew their Bibles enough to stand up against this madness of exterminating a whole nation, of brainwashing all the Germans. And they ended up, even though they were German, they ended up in the concentration camps. Just to give you two names, Martin Niemöller ended up in a concentration camp. This is the guy who wrote, "When they came for the Social Democrats." I didn't speak up because I was not a Social Democrat. "When they came for the Communists," I didn't speak up because I was not a Communist. "When they came up for the homosexuals," I didn't speak up because I was not a homosexual. "When they came up for the Jews," I didn't speak up because I was not a Jew. And then they came up for me, and there was nobody left to speak up. Martin Niemöller ended in a concentration camp, and one day five of his friends, pastors, Lutheran pastors, came to visit him and asked him, "Martin, what are you doing here? This is the place for the Jews. This is the place for the Communists. What are you doing here? You're a good person." And Martin asked them in return, "The right question is not what I am doing here. The right question is, why are you not also here?" And the answer is, because they put their German nationality first and Jesus second. Another pastor that had the guts to stand up and speak against this madness was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And he was killed literally a few days before the German regime fell down. Because the majority has decided that they are first Germans and second Christians. If we have to learn a lesson from history, here it is. We are first and foremost followers of Jesus. Did you hear that? You are not first American. You are first and foremost follower of Jesus. We should never mindlessly obey a regime that asks us to put Christ second. Because if we do, we'll become suicide bombers and religious fanatics. And people are going to die, if not physically, many times spiritually. And as a matter of fact, I may probably should say, actually many times physically. When we were in Austria with my wife, I had the conversation with several elderly members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church who in tears shared with me this story. "We are ashamed of what happened during the time of Hitler. The SS, these are the secret services of the German government back then, they came in church, interrupted the sermon. The officer will stand up on the platform and will ask the question, 'Are there any Jews in your congregation?' And these people who told me the story, they said, 'Yes, we had Jewish people who converted from Judaism to Christianity. And now they were praising Jesus and sitting with us and worshiping with us.' And we just stood up and pointed our fingers. She is a Jew. He is a Jew. And these people were taken from the place of worship, and we never saw them again. Because some people thought that they are first Austrians or first Germans, and second, Christians. There is a German proverb, it goes like that. Al, you're going to be probably the only one who is going to get it, but probably someone is watching us from Germany or Austria. Wer seine Geschichte nicht kennt, ist dazu verdammt, sie es ewig zu wiederholen. Whoever does not learn his spiritual history, this is an approximate translation, is condemned to repeat its mistakes over and over and over again. Now, let's move to the last section and then discover the third reason why Bible-believing Christians sometimes become spiritual terrorists. So, anyone please help me out and read for us verses 31 through 36. Not all at once, please. Charlene, lift up your hand high. Look there, David. So let's hear verses 31 through 36.
And as they were trying to kill him, word came to the tribune of the cohort that all Jerusalem was in confusion. He at once took soldiers and centurions and ran down to them. And when they saw the tribune and the soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. Then the tribune came up and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. He inquired who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing, some another. And as he could not learn the facts because of the uproar, he ordered him to be brought into the barracks. And when he came to the steps, he was actually carried by the soldiers because of the violence of the crowd. For the mob of the people followed crying, "Away with him."
Now, if it were not for the national enemies of the Jews, which were the Romans, Paul would have been torn to shreds by these people who read up their Bibles, and in the Bible says you should love God with all your heart and you should love also your neighbor as yourself. And this was in the Old Testament, not just in the New. Here you see a reconstruction of the temple area. This is the court of the Gentiles, and here is the wall. Probably you cannot see it from the Fortress Antonia. This is where part of the 10th Legion, Roman Legion, was stationed there. On average day, they will have approximately 1,000 soldiers stationed there. And Lysias, at that time, was the commanding officer. He was the Heliar, that means commander of thousands. And when he saw this riot in the temple area, he dispatched at least 200 soldiers, because it says he dispatched two centurions, and the centurions is in charge of 100 soldiers, so that they can go into the temple and create order. And the people were beating up so badly Paul, and they so badly wanted him torn to shreds, that the soldiers literally have to lift him up and carry him up in the air so that they cannot reach him. Now, the Jewish people wanted Apostle Paul dead because he brought a very novel idea that challenged their old time established religion. Did you hear what I just said? He brought a very novel idea. Today we know in retrospect They say hindsight is what? 20/20. You see things much better. But these were Bible reading and Bible believing Christians who wanted to tear to pieces Paul because he brought a very novel idea that challenged the established religion. And this is the third reason why people become spiritual and sometimes physical terrorists. When you close your mind for new ideas, you have become a religious fanatic. And I can speak from a personal experience, because there was a time when I was thinking that reading anything else but things that come from Review and Herald, which is the Adventist publication house, is a bad. And yes, things that are coming from outside, you have to read them carefully and with one in mind that some of the things may not be true, but the same is true about the things that are coming from Review and Herald sometimes. So, when you close your mind from ideas that come out of the traditional avenues, watch very carefully, because you are bound to become a religious fanatic. And one more characteristic I would like to share about religious fanatics. Religious fanatics want to share their faith and their religious views with others, but they seldom allow anyone else to share his or her religious views with them. When we have developed this mentality, and I see it so often among Christians, and especially among Seventh-day Adventist Christians, when we see this mentality, this fortress mentality, where we are lifting up high these walls so that nobody is going to influence us. Who are you kidding? Do you have a TV at home? You're already influenced. Religious fanatics are people who never want to listen to a new idea, and they're going to reject it just because it's novel and just because it challenges the old. And I know this is a scary thing to say, but I also believe that God gave us two brains, or some say more than that. God gave us head on our shoulders so that we can think. God gave us knees so that we can go on our knees and pray. And God gave us the scriptures so that we can understand them in the spirit of the character of God. Amen. And when we do that, you don't have to be afraid that you're going to be led astray. And I know that every single time I explain the Bible, I give enough proof. I don't need to give you anything more. You already heard what you need to hear. But I know that some people, either watching us online or maybe even in these pews, are such hardcore all-time religion people that unless I give them a quotation from one of our founders by the name of Ellen White, they're not going to believe me. So I'm going to do exactly that. I'm going to give a quotation. Here is what she said, and actually she said this on several occasions, but the quotation I have here is from Review and Herald in 1892. She says, "We have many lessons to learn. That means we do not know everything. New ideas are welcome. And we have many, many to unlearn. That means some of the things that we are doing are wrong, friends. God and heaven alone are infallible. Those who think that they will never have to give up a cherished view, never have occasion to change an opinion, will be disappointed." The city of Jerusalem rejected the gospel and the messenger. The city of Jerusalem was on borrowed time. These events that we just discussed about happened in 58 AD, 12 years later. The temple of Jerusalem, the cherished pillar of the faith, has to be taken away. The pride of the Jewish people has to be taken away, because they have made an idol out of the truth with a lowercase t, and have rejected the one who gave the reason for the existence of this temple, the truth with a capital T. And friends, if you think that this happens just to the Jewish people, think again. Oftentimes, way too often, the things we are proud of and desperately try to protect as a pillar of our faith, these are the very things that become an obstacle in proclaiming our God-given message. Because when we leave the truth with a capital T out of what we have to share, it is worth exactly that much. Take Jesus of all our fundamental beliefs and you can throw them away. They're worthless. Unfortunately, the Jewish people thought that you can have all religious beliefs, cherish them and hug them and cuddle them without Jesus. Today, on behalf of God, I'm praying and I'm asking God to be merciful to me, to be merciful to all of us. May we never repeat the mistakes of the Jewish people. To love the truth with a lowercase t and sacrifice and reject the truth with a capital T. May He bless us to not be anymore Seventh-day Adventist terrorists. To not be mean to people, to embrace the character of God and to treat people the way He does treat them. Because He cherishes people so much that He died for them. And oftentimes we are willing to wound them and to hurt them because they do not see the way we see, because they do not understand the things that we understand. And we cannot grasp that God may lead some people different ways. But they're okay as long as they walk with the truth, with a capital T. And when the time is ripe, when the time is when they are ready, they're going to come also to the truth with a lowercase t. But in the meantime, let them see that we are people who are in love with the truth with a capital T. So, would you please, guys, help me out? Take out of your bulletins the yellow connection card, and let's make a few practical decisions, practical choices of life before we conclude this service. First step I would like to propose, Lord, teach me how to be passionate about my beliefs without bullying those who do not share my convictions. That's a very tough thing to do. I have been challenged by this very many times. To cherish your beliefs, to cherish what God has revealed to us, and yet to not be so arrogant as to try to force them on people who are not ready to accept them. Second, religious people can become obsessed with their religion to the point of turning into tyrants and terrorists. May God preserve my faith and keep it grounded in God's character of love and grace. And finally, Lord, help me to not reject the truth with capital T for the small truths which might have become the essence of my religion. May God bless us all to never fall out of love with our Lord Jesus, who is the truth, the way, and the true life. Without Him, we spiritually die. May God bless us.
Our closing hymn is hymn 523, My Faith Has Found a Resting Place. Everyone with me. My faith has found a resting place, not in a man-made creed. I trust the ever-living one, that He for me will plead. I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. Ladies only on this stanza. Come on, ladies. Everyone now.
I need no other evidence. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. Come with me now, men. My soul is resting on the Word, the living Word of God. Salvation in my Savior's name, salvation through the blood. Everyone, I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. Last stanza. The great physician heals the sick, the lost he came to save. For me his precious blood he shed, for me his life he gave. Sing it out now. I need no other evidence, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me.
Would you please bow with me your heads for the benediction? And I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me, because he continued his faith in me, putting me even into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer and persecutor and an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because of who Christ is and the grace that the Lord Jesus gave me in exceeding amount was not in vain, because for me to live is Christ and to die a privilege. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for challenging us this morning. And I'm shaken by this message, even though I preached it. I had to internalize and absorb this throughout the week. And I would like to ask you today, as my brothers and sisters just heard it anew, to not fade away, to make a lasting impression on our human hearts, and to never become religious fanatics again. Yes, we've been like that, like Paul has been. Yes, we have been people who have hurt others because we have not understood the deep character of grace and love you possess. But today we learn and we know better. And help us, Lord, to be like you. Bless us to get out of the clause of this truth with the capital T. Emptied of your presence, and to grow into understanding that every single truth and doctrine we have gains a new meaning when you're in it. Thank you so much for being you. Thank you so much for living for us such a powerful testimony through Paul. And bless us today as we enjoy the Sabbath day, to make it a day of communion and renewing of heart. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray, and all the people of God said together. Amen.